welcome everyone to another episode of Talk with the Doc. My name is Janvi, and throughout this series I will be talking to doctors of different specialities, and those at different stages of their medical journeys, to learn more about the variety of opportunities within medicine. In today's episode of Talk with the Doc, I'm going to be talking to Dr. Shamim Mustafa, a paediatric consultant working at Basildon Hospital.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mustafa, for talking to me today. I am really grateful for this opportunity, especially because when I first thought about the career of medicine, being a pediatrician was actually one of my first careers that I envisaged for myself, because it sounds like so much fun working with children. But I know now that obviously there's so much more to it, and I just wanted to learn some more about that from you.
So thank you for inviting me for the interview. So you mentioned that you were interested in pediatrics. Pediatrics is a wonderful part of medicine, a specialty that, you know, one could choose. And it is something like a general practitioner, but only more, because you have a look at the baby from birth all the way till about 16 to 18 years. But, you know, there are lots of specialties in pediatrics, just like in medicine. So you can be a general pediatrician, or you could even be a neonatologist. So neonatologist, it's even more exciting. It means you're looking after babies who are born very early. And right now, in this day and age, we start looking at resuscitating babies from 22 to 23 weeks.
Wow.
So you can imagine, babies the size of a Coke can, babies who weigh maybe about 400 grams, we help them, we resuscitate them, we help them live. They are very, very fragile in the first few months, but we, you know, go through a journey with them. So that is one of the best parts of pediatrics, neonatology.
That is very interesting.
Yes, yeah. I mean, that is just one specialty of pediatrics. So, you know, you have lots of other things as well. You have like cardiology, neurology, gastroenterology, so lots of specialties. So, you know, if you think about pediatrics, I mean, like I said, that is one of the best specialty that you could think of joining. And you will never have a dull day in pediatrics.
That sounds very interesting. I didn't realize that pediatrics itself is broken down to all these subspecialties. So when you go through your training process, do you first go into pediatrics and then subspecialize? Or do you first choose your area of like the human body that you want to specialize in and then choose to go down pediatrics?
Okay, so that's a very good question. Now, here in the UK, training in pediatrics is different from training in other specialties, for example, medicine or cardiology or dermatology. So first of all, I mean, you spend about 4 to 5 years in med school. Mm-hmm. And after you finish your degree, then you have 2 years of foundation training. So that's F1 and F2. Mm-hmm. And in those 2 years, you spend about 4 months in different specialties. So you can choose some specialties, or you know, it's given to you. Mm-hmm. And that gives you an opportunity to work in different specialist places and experience, and also try to think of what you would benefit greatly as a career. So after those 2 years, then you apply for training program in pediatrics. So that's through the Royal College of Pediatrics and Child Health. Mm-hmm. And if you're chosen, then you get a number. So you get, you know, you're enrolled as a specialty trainee.
Oh.
Now, training in pediatrics is 8 years.
Wow.
Okay. So unlike other specialties, it used to be 8 years when I was in training, mm-hmm. but now they're trying to cut it down because we want more people into the specialty. So at the end of those, I mean, in 8 years, but every 6 months you go into different hospitals or in different specialist fields. For example, you could do 6 months of intensive care in pediatrics. You could do 6 months in neonatal intensive care.
Right.
You could do a year in general pediatrics. You could do 6 months in cardiology. You could do 6 months or a year in A&E. So it depends on what you choose. Or you can also be a community pediatrician. So you look after, you know, children with long-term illnesses or disabilities. So, you know, it is very vast. Choices are, you know, you're spoiled for choice, really.
That sounds wonderful. It sounds like there's a really broad spectrum within being a pediatrician. What did you choose out of interests?
Well, I chose neonatology. So I am a general pediatrician by profession,
right,
but my special interest is neonatology. So I look after babies from, like I said, from 23, 24 week onwards. Mm-hmm. Now, the hospital I work is what's known as a district general hospital. Mm-hmm. So we, you know, we do have deliveries of babies who are born extremely preterm. So like I said, from 22 or 23 weeks. And if they're born in our hospital, what we do is we stabilize those babies, so we give them a chance, and then once they're stable, then we move them on to a bigger hospital. So what's known as a level 3 unit. So there they only look after the extremely preterm or the very fragile babies. But that is a journey in itself, because from the moment that a very tiny baby is born preterm, till the time they're transferred to another hospital, I mean, you have to imagine, the baby is born through the birth canal. We have to handle the baby on the what's known as a resuscitator. We stabilize the baby. Then we move the baby from the delivery suite to the neonatal unit through a special transport incubator. And from there, once the baby is stable, we put our lines and everything else. And then we call a specialist team who come in and retrieve the baby. So the journey from the delivery suite till our ward to another hospital is quite precarious. And you know, for a very preterm baby, it is quite daunting as well. And also for the people involved in the care of this baby, because like I said, these babies who may be up to 400 grams, their eyes are, in some occasion, they're fused, the skin is very, very thin. You know, you do your best to make sure that the baby has a good chance at survival. And some of them, most of them do, you know, if you handle them in the right way, most of them do. Of course, some of them will have some problems along the way because they were born very early. But, you know, with all the innovations that's happening, we are winning.
That sounds amazing, especially the job satisfaction from, because as you said, these babies are born very preterm and you get to see the development over these weeks and you get to be able to save someone so small. That does sound like a really satisfying job. But also you did say that because they're in such a delicate phase of their life, you know, they're born so early. There could be many other complications, and obviously there is the chance of losing the life. And you know, pediatrics as a whole to me seems like a very rewarding career, but also it does have the idea that if you lose the life of a child, it does seem to be so much more daunting. So how are you able to keep up with that stress, and how are you able to cope with it?
Well, yes, like you said, it can be very stressful, but it is also very rewarding, because for all the babies that survive and they leave the unit after months of stay in hospital, it gives you a good sense of relief and, you know, satisfaction that you've made that difference. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, yes, we don't win all the time. And that is, you know, the bare truth. And that is in general, in any specialty that you may think of. Mm-hmm. But you have to remember that you learn from experience and you work as a team. So you're not an individual who has the burden of the world on your shoulders. In any specialty or any department in medicine or pediatrics, you work in a team. So there's always a team effort. And when one person wins, the whole team wins. When one person's down, the whole team is down. So we are all there for each other. And that's the best way, you know, team spirit. So that gets you through all the tough times or the sad times and, you know, pushes you forward to all the good times as well. So that is part of the job satisfaction on being a doctor. Yes.
That sounds great. Definitely really inspiring. And this is, when I was younger, it was one of the things I always used to think about, working with babies as well. It sounds like such a fascinating career. And also the idea, as you said, there's so much innovation that we can save babies that were born so early. I never assumed we could save, you know, that there is technology now and there is advancement in medicine that we can save babies who are 22 weeks old. That sounds very, very fascinating and just astounding. You also mentioned you're a general pediatrician as well. So does that mean you also see children from all the way from, obviously babies as that's your subspecialty, but all the way up to 16? So you see children of all different ages?
Exactly, all ages, all the way. I mean, from infancy all the way till puberty or adolescence. So up to 18 in some, for example, if we have diabetic children, they're seen up until 18 years of age. Mm-hmm. Some children with neuro disabilities are seen till 18 years of age. But in general, 16 is a cutoff because right. at 16, that young person has the body of an adult. Mm-hmm. And the physiology, everything's different. Right. And also, I mean, you know, we finish that tender loving care bit and then we hand them over to the adult physicians who are actually, I mean, they also do a fantastic job and they look after us. So
that's great. With such a wide age range, I understand, of course, that pediatrics is, of course, very different to adult physiology, as you said. But even from, you know, being 0 days old as a baby to being 16, that is a huge age range to cater for. And there must be so much development. So how are you able to, I mean, it makes sense that there's 8 years of training, but how are you able to learn so much that you're able to cater for all different ages? Because, of course, there's different state, you know, changes along the way.
Yes. So it's all your basic anatomy, basic physiology that prepares you. For example, a newborn baby or a preterm baby will have a heartbeat of 140 to 180 per minute. And for an adult, I mean, the average heartbeat is about 70. For an athlete, it's about 40. So you can imagine the wide difference in heartbeat, and that's just a heartbeat. And then there's the breathing. So a baby would breathe about 60 times a minute, whereas an adult would breathe about 15 to 20 times at the most a minute. So you have to understand the different physiological parameters, and then you treat it accordingly. So if an adult came to me with a heartbeat of 150, then I would say, oh no, there's something wrong. But whereas a baby brought to me with a heartbeat of 140 or 150, I'd say, okay, that's fine. Nothing to worry about there, you know. So you have to have good, strong, basic foundation. So you learn a lot in med school. You learn a lot when you go into training. And like I said, I mean, the parameters are different in the newborn to infancy, to young childhood, to the teenage years and to adolescence. So you learn through all of this. And the way they present is also different. So a lot of hard work while you're training, while you're studying, and that will bear fruit when you see those patients.
That sounds like a great variety of things that you have to learn about and also be able to apply. So thinking about, there's all these opportunities and all this variety in your job. What would a typical day in the life look like? Because of course you have your subspecialty of neonatal care, but also, you know, being a general pediatrician. Is your working days different?
No, because I mean, it's hard to say how each day would pan out really, because a typical day for me, as consultants, we have different rotas. So, you know, we work in clinics. So you see about between 20 to 30 patients a day in clinic. And there you deal with the child, but not only the child, but with the parents as well. And sometimes, you know, parents come in with they want to hear something else, and they may not be satisfied with what you tell them. But then you have to understand their perspective as well. That is clinic work. So clinic work is where you deal with patients who are stable, with children who are absolutely stable. So you know what they may be coming in for a diagnosis, or they've already got a diagnosis, and it's just management just seeing how things are happening, progressing, so monitoring. Whereas when you work on the ward, it's different. Mm-hmm. So on the ward, you have your daily ward rounds. So before the ward round, in all specialties, we have a handover. So the team that was in night will hand over to the day team. They let us know of all the new admissions, what's been happening with all the patients on the ward, and who they're worried about most. So then we sort of organize our day. Because we have to finish not just the ward round, we have to do other things. For example, some of the children may need procedures doing, we've got to do that. We may need to make phone calls to different specialists, get other people to come and see the child. And then if they're well and parents are happy, then we also discharge them. And then we get new admissions through the day. So that is, you know, so a typical day would start at about 7:30 when you need to be in hospital. Yeah. Handover starts at about 8 o'clock, finishes by 8:30. So half an hour handover. Then we may have teaching sessions. So, you know, we need to keep ourselves updated all the time. And so that's why the hospital I work, it's a university teaching hospital. So we have teaching programs almost every day. So we spend about an hour every day teaching. So we'll be teaching the juniors, or the juniors will be presenting cases, or other specialists will be coming and giving us lectures on certain topics. So that will be updated. Then we carry on with the ward work by about 10 o'clock. We finish all of that by around 1 o'clock. Then we may have working lunch, because during lunch breaks, we have meetings with other people. And then we go around seeing parents, reviewing patients, reviewing new admissions. And then by 4 o'clock, we get ready to hand over to the evening team or night team. We head on home, but our work is not over yet, because as doctors, you constantly think of your patients or what you've had, your experience through the day, and your mind keeps on working all the time. So even though you're watching a football match, or you're making a pasta, or you're having dinner, you'll still be thinking of certain cases. And then the light bulb clicks at that moment when you least expect it. Aha, I should have thought about that, or I need to do this or that. And then you get on the phone, and then you call your colleague and say, actually, I think that you need to do these kind of investigations. And then they call you in the middle of the night to say, oh, you were right, that's come out as positive, and that's what it is, and presto. So that's how the mind of a doctor works. You're never sort of turned off work. You're always on, even though you might seem like, you're doing something else. For example, I like to do lots of DIY or joinery work, myself busy. But even when I'm doing all of those things, I think about certain patients, how they presented, and then I quickly go through, or I ring my colleagues and find out how those patients are, and if they've had all those tests, or so always catching up.
I can see that's really hard as the shop work, especially as a doctor, but even when you're working with children, I can imagine what that must be like. But do you find it easy to still manage a good work-life balance? I understand that obviously you somewhere in the back of your mind, your part of your mind is still there thinking about your patients, but are you able to get a good amount of time off work as well?
I am actually. I mean, at this stage of my career where I've had so many years of experience, I am able to actually switch off, because I know that, when I do a handover, I hand over to my capable colleagues and a capable team. So like I said, it's not a one-man show. It's a team. So you always know that you have backup. You've got that somebody who's got your back. So that way, you are okay. In the beginning, when I started off working, obviously it was stressful because everything was new. We learned from textbooks. We did some practical procedures on mannequins. We saw other people doing things. And it was always stressful. I mean, when you have to do it, when it's your turn, are you able to step up? And then have you done the right thing? You may sometimes get cross patients or angry parents, but then you learn to get over it. And, you speak to other colleagues, you learn from their experience. And that way you slowly get less stressed, because whatever you're doing, you're doing it as a team, and you've got other people's advice on board. So that way it gets less stressful.
It definitely sounds like a really positive sort of information I'm getting from you, that it can be stressful, it can be challenging, but you always have a team. And also, I can see that you clearly love your job, because the idea that you're still thinking about your patients shows that obviously it's that kind of material that of course you still care, but the idea that you want to try and give the best care possible even when you're not physically there, that just sounds amazing and very inspiring. Yeah. You talked about the idea of the parents of patients, because of course that is another thing you have to take into consideration as being a pediatrician. Is that challenging to be able to communicate with parents, because of course they're going to be very concerned and often may not understand everything you're telling them? But also about the idea of communicating with the patient themselves, the child. Is that easy to do, or does that pose some challenges?
Yes, so that's a very good question, and it's all about building rapport. So communication is very essential to be a successful medic, a successful a physician, or a doctor. You need to have a clear link of communication, not just with the parents, but with the patients, with your nursing staff, with the juniors, with the admin team. So as long as you have a clear line of communication, then things will go great for you. And sometimes, yes, like I said, when a child is unwell and they're brought to hospital, then the parents are obviously quite stressed, because the child is probably in pain or distressed. So there is a level of anxiety. And as pediatrician, you know, as pediatrician, your duty is to take that on board and understand, empathize with the parents, empathize with the patients, and take it on board. You know, and then you explain what's going on. You have to keep them in the loop, because, for example, as physicians, you have people who go to see their GPs or their doctors, and they verbalize what the problem is. So they let people know. They let the doctors know. They say, "I've got a tummy pain. Can you help me?" And then the doctor prescribes some medicines, or they order scans or whatever, and then they're off. But with children, with pediatrics, in babies, they can't tell you what's happening. All they'll do is they'll not have their milk, or they'll be sick, or they'll be crying, or they'll have a temperature. So the parents obviously don't know, and they bring those, you know, babies or those children to you as a pediatrician. Then you have to, first of all, try to figure out what's going. And for that, you need a good communication with the family. So you get a good history, a good detailed history, and then you do a thorough assessment. And then based on your findings, you come into differential diagnosis. So, you know, probable diagnosis and possible diagnosis. You have to tell the parents that this is what you think is going on. And you also, you know, where the child is able to understand, you let them know as well. So you have to look them, you know, you have to look at them in the eye, and you have to empathize with the child, with the parents, and let them know what's going on, and what you think we need to do. For example, we may just give them medicines and then see how they are. If they're fine, we send them home. Or we may need to do the dreaded blood test. And again, you know, that is a high level of anxiety, because although we say blood test and that's okay, for a child who's having the blood test, it is not okay, because for them, you know, they associate all of that with terrible pains. So they get more anxious and they're crying. And in most occasions, parents also start crying when they see their babies or child crying. So again, you have to communicate, and then we use other things like magic cream or numbing cream before we do blood tests. So then those you know, children or babies don't have any pain. We do the tests. We you know, ask them to wait, and then we continuously observe those children. And then we once we get those results, we tell them, okay, this is what we think it is, and this is what we'll do. And that way, you build a good you know, a rapport with the patients, with the family, and also you know, they trust you. Once the parents or the patients trust you, then your job is much more easier. There are some times when parents are quite aggressive. And that, again, is because they're quite stressed. So you have to understand that, and you have to deal with the situation.
That sounds great. It sounds like it's all about problem solving, but also being honest and being able to build that rapport, as you said, with your patients, and for them to be able to trust you, which I think is the same for any medical specialty. It's all about having a good patient-doctor relationship, which is clearly evident from what you've told me. This all sounds really wonderful, and it's definitely encouraged me to enter pediatrics as a line further down, you know, my training if I end up becoming a doctor. Sounds wonderful. Is there any piece of advice finally you have to give me and other medics who might be watching this as to, you know, how to enter pediatrics and what will make you a successful pediatrician?
Yes, it's all about commitment. So, you know, first of all, when you want to do medicine, then you have to be committed. You have to do the hard work, the legwork, to get your grades. And when you get your grades and prepare for your universities, and once you're through, then you have to have a very strong foundation. So you have to attend all those lectures, do all those, you know, assessments, read through those books, go, you know, burn the midnight oil, study hard. And then also when you go into placements, then obviously you follow the junior doctors, the senior doctors, ask a lot of questions. So you have to be very interactive. You can't just stand in the corner and just do nothing. You have to be always interactive. So that way, you know, you learn more. You're like, your brain is like a sponge. You have to absorb everything that's happening. So all the experience from everywhere, you understand and you absorb that, and then you put that into practice. So it's all about hard work and commitment. And once, you know, you go into pediatrics, like I said, it's an amazing specialty, and you can have a special interest in anything from head to toe. So from brain to podiatry or orthopedics. So wow. Yeah, a wide variety of specialty that you can choose. And it is, like I said, it's very rewarding in the end.
Great. That sounds so wonderful. Thank you so much for talking to me. This has genuinely been so insightful and has really encouraged me to think about this as a potential career further down the line. So thank you so much for your time today. I really enjoyed talking to you.
Most welcome. Take care, Jenny.